Hi, I'm Nick Dilks. I'm a co-founder, managing partner of Ecosystem Investment Partners. We're based in Baltimore, just up the road. I actually wrote the business plan for our firm at the R.H. Smith School 12 years ago. So I got a B minus on it, but it actually worked out in the end. what we do is we're actually a private equity investment firm. What we do is invest in environmental markets. So I'm hopefully going to touch on one marketplace that's hopefully doing some good things for the world and making some money as well. We've had some good success. In the past 10 years, we've raised over $500 million in three separate investment funds to invest in ecosystem restoration projects all over the country. Our investors are actually entirely profit focused. So they're pension funds, endowments, high net worth families that are looking for principally economic returns. Some have an environmental focus. They like the conservation byproduct of what we do, we call it. But again, we're trying to find ways to make investing in the environment profitable to expand capital available to do large scale projects. So what are environmental markets? The ones we focus on are, there are lots of them, but the biggest ones that we've really focused on is the notion that there are is a growing need for environmental offsets. Environmental offsets, typically in the form of what we call mitigation credits, are in demand because there are various federal, state, and local environmental laws in the United States in particular that require you to offset your environmental impacts if they are unavoidable and impact things like wetlands or streams, endangered species, or things like nutrient and sediment, which is a big deal here now in Maryland. And I'll talk a bit about that. So what we do is we go out and go across the country and find places where there are lots of ongoing impacts to things like wetlands in northern Minnesota, where 95% of all the iron ore in the United States comes from. It's also a lot of wetlands. And so those iron mines need to offset their environmental impacts. We restore wetlands to produce credits. They buy the credits to offset their impacts. And so they're able to proceed with a good development project. The environment is restored by our project. And we're able to charge a profit for the credits we sell. And so it generates an opportunity for investors to make money, for the environment to be improved, and for good economic development projects to go forward. The key thing that's created this opportunity, I would say, in addition to a really good vehicle to provide compromise in the environment, which is the key thing, is that we don't want to just say, hey, no development, and we also want to say no environmental protection. We really want both. The key thing was to come up with a system whereby we could create a unit of measure for environmental benefit. And that's really the key thing. It sounds a little complicated, but the idea is instead of when a company or, say, the Maryland Highway Department needs to impact a wetland, instead of saying, we think you ought to pay this much money to offset your impact, what we say is if you're going to impact an acre of wetlands or a mile of stream or dump a ton of nutrient or sediment into the Chesapeake Bay, you need to offset that unit of ecological measure. And we, the regulators that require that, aren't going to tell you how much that costs. You just need to produce the restored acre. And so if I can produce a restored acre, that unit, and the buyer of that unit that needs to get a permit to build a shopping center thinks that price is okay, and they don't need to know what my cost is. And obviously, I can fit a profit in there and generate a return for my investors. And so that's what we do. Another good example that's growing here in Maryland, and I don't know if Dan Neese is here or not, but there's a really interesting growing market.
He just left.
Okay, convenient. Dan's convinced me to get involved in our first project in Maryland. We actually don't do many things here locally, but a new environmental market that's really growing here in Maryland across the country, again, is focused on nutrient and sediment pollution of water bodies like the Chesapeake Bay. That's probably the biggest environmental impact to that water body that's going on. So when you have a failing septic system, when you have a sewage treatment plant, that puts nitrogen and phosphorus and sediment in the Chesapeake Bay, causes algae blooms and other things that aren't good for water quality. Well, the notion now is that regulations basically say that instead of stopping all production of more nutrient or sediment into the Chesapeake Bay, which may be impossible if you have a growing community, there's going to be more treated sewage or septic going into the Chesapeake Bay, we still need to have an offset to that. So what firms like ours can do is go onto, say, a dairy farm where you maybe have very degraded streams, where you have very poor manure management systems going in, and we can invest our capital in restoring streams, restoring wetlands, improving that runoff so that it reduces the amount of pollution coming off of another property, and sell that credit then to a sewage treatment plant, a community that needs to reduce their nutrient or sediment output to remain in compliance. And again, if I can produce a project, a pound of reduction that someone will pay for, and I can produce that pound at a fraction of what someone else will pay for it, there's an investment opportunity. So this is what we do all over the country. We're not the only people doing it. We are now actually the largest source of capital in the country doing this type of work. And it all started right here at R.H. Smith. So I'm going to be a minute under, actually, if that's okay with you. Okay, good. Thanks.
Can I take Nick's minute? Is that how that works? Just silence is consent. Really happy to be here. Hi, everybody. My name is Rohana Nathu. I lead the impact investing work at the Case Foundation. Just by show of hands, who knows what impact investing is? Oh, yeah. Yeah, you guys could probably come up here. So for the purpose of being concise, I'm going to offer a definition. It's investments into companies, funds, and products that intentionally intend to generate both a social return and a financial return. There's two pieces of that definition that I just want to highlight briefly. If you take away nothing else, remember this. Impact investing is investing, and impact investing is about intentionality. Back in November, Justin Rockefeller, who is a board member of the Rockefeller Brothers Fund and a co-founder of The Impact, sat in on a webinar led by Gene Case. And in the webinar, Gene basically asked him, how do you define impact? And he offered an example that I'm going to poach momentarily, because I think it's helpful to talk about how one definition of impact can actually serve as two. And so Justin was saying, imagine that we thought about Mothers Against Drunk Drivers, or MAD. And imagine that MAD had an endowment and they needed to invest for their mission. And their mission is to reduce the number of alcohol-related fatalities on the road. So they might think that an investment in Uber is an impact investment, right? It is a affordable, cost-sharing, convenient alternative to getting behind the wheel while drunk. Okay, so imagine instead the New York City taxi company. Imagine how they feel about Uber. Imagine how they feel about an investment into an alternative that decreases the demand for a good, stable job. One investment, two totally different definitions of impact. So from a Case Foundation perspective, how do we sort of contend with this? Quite simply put, we don't. We appreciate and sort of understand that the definition of impact is particularly subjective. And so instead, we are rigid on two things, three things technically. Why and how through three dimensions. And I'm just going to take a second to talk about those dimensions because I think that they're inherent in how we think about impact investing. So the first is around intentionality. So intentionality being, did you accidentally create some really good jobs, or more importantly, did you intend to do that? Was it so explicit in the way that you designed your investment or your company that it was part of who you are? The second piece is around measurement. Social impact measurement is like the worst four-letter word you can think of, and it's not even. I mean, people are completely obsessed with standardization and then customization. Social impact measurement measures nothing, it measures everything. And so we know that it's sort of wrought with a lot of infancy, but despite that, are you intending to track across social measures as much as humanly possible? And then the third piece is, if you decide to measure, do you boldly share? One of the things that we contend with in the impact investing industry is these pervasive myths, right? It's charity, it's a couple of do-gooders, it's a couple of asset owners, it's never going to scale. The best way to sort of contend with that is for us to be able to have real examples of what impact looks like. So once you've done it, whether you're successful or you're not, do you plan to share with the field? So if we believe that impact investing is critically important in understanding and communicating, which is a Case Foundation principle, why now? Why are we particularly concerned with this now? Those of you that are sort of aware of the evolution of the Sustainable Development Goals knows that in 2014, they updated them, right? So from the MDGs, 17 goals that basically look to promote quality of life around the world. So once the goals came out, there was an assessment of exactly what it would take to fund them. And the assessment was $2.5 trillion a year. So between 2014 and 2030, when they're hoped to be achieved, it's about $40 trillion of financing needed. Private development assistance, so non-revenue, nonprofit-oriented giving by the world's most wealthiest countries last year was $43 billion. So over the same period of time, private development could only achieve about 1.7% of our financing target. And yet, conversely, global assets under management last year was $100 trillion, and that could achieve the SDGs 2.5 times over. So for us, the financial market opportunity for impact investing is huge. It brings the rigor of the private sector, a market-based system that we've seen work time and again, and then the very, very careful and thoughtful consideration of the public sector around what development means and ties it all together. And I think it's a particularly unique moment in time for us to be talking about impact investing because there's two major trends that we think is sort of changing the way we talk about impact and, in fact, normalizing it. The first big one, I don't know how many of you know this, but the global high net worth individual industry is expected to surpass $100 trillion by 2025. That's huge. That means that the wealthier are getting wealthy and the poorer are getting poorer, and the gap between the two is astronomical. And of that wealth that will be accumulated, what's particularly interesting is that women and families are going to maintain ownership of 70% of that wealth over the next two generations. And after women, millennials will inherit somewhere between $30 to $40 trillion from their baby boomer parents. It's a lot. It's a lot of money. And what's particularly interesting about women and millennial asset owners, we are talking about the wealthy, but what's interesting about them is there isn't a profit bucket here and a purpose bucket here. Those two objectives are so much better linked in the way that they view the world than any demographic before. And so instead of waiting until they're retired or until they've made all their money, they're thinking actively about how to do both in real time. So that's one exciting trend because it means that impact investing, which will allow the generation of revenue and the generation of social impact, can maybe exist a little earlier. The second piece that's interesting is the way that millennials are being talked about sort of socially in our own fabric today. So millennials will sort of dominate 75% of the workforce in the United States in the next 10 years. So 1 in 3 employees in the US today are millennials. And you guys know this from your own life. Millennials is just a fancy term to say consumer, investor, social media expert, social media novice in my case. It doesn't matter what hat you wear, you're a human being that's exercising your dollar and your values. So if we actually believe that a millennial demographic, it's a broad generalization, but if we believe that it's a much more profit and purpose oriented demographic, it means that impact investing is going to be a tool in their tool belt. And so as you guys think about what mainstreaming impact investing means, and I'm here after this conversation for any questions you might have, I encourage you to consider that we all can be part of mainstreaming that movement. And in doing that, three things to keep in mind. And most specifically, that would be intentional, measure what matters to you, and share. Share boldly. Thank you.
Thank you. Wow, that made me feel inspired. Great. Hi. My name is Natasha, and I, about a year ago, started a company called Eon. And what we do is we're developing a system for textile recycling. Believe it or not, there is no system today. Actually, fashion is the number 2 most polluting industry in the world, second only to oil, which will put a new perspective on everything that you wear. And about 90% of fashion ends up in landfill. 80 billion new articles are produced every single year. So when I started around this interest in fashion and in textile, it was really grounded in this sustainability interest, and first and foremost, in an interest in waste and in an interest in trash. I never thought that I would graduate from college and be interested in trash, but it happened. It could happen to you. So we started to think about how can we, given that there are so many materials already in the world, and given that they're already being used, we actually have enough clothes to last us all forever that already exists, that are already out there. We don't actually need to make any more cotton. We actually have enough cotton already in the world to last forever. So how can we start thinking about this new term around quote-unquote circular fashion, or which emulates thinking of the circular economy? Is anyone familiar with that idea? Okay, good. Your university is doing you well. So What is the difference between linear and circular? So basically, the linear model that we practice today is you take natural resources, you make products, and then from there you produce waste. So this idea of circular economy is a fancy word for recycling, which really is about taking these same natural resources and producing new products from that, which basically completely eliminates your reliance on new natural resources and also completely ends the production of waste. Right? So what exactly are the barriers to circular fashion or the barriers to circular economy as a whole? That's what we started to look at. And the real barrier today is data, information. How can you start to use data and knowledge and intelligent systems to actually facilitate this? So right now, you think, okay, well, if I have a piece of clothing, how do I make sure it's recycled? If I have a printer or secondhand object, how do I know where it is, where to take it? How do you keep all of these materials that are in the world at highest and best use at all times? So the answer is information and data. So we started to develop a system called EonID, which is around tagging assets and having those assets correlated with a unique identity in the cloud. It's a bit similar to, let's say you scan a barcode. That barcode could actually tell you the exact material content of something. So if you look at how the recycling system actually works today, what happens is a bunch of clothes come in, and basically there are people standing there trying to feel the materials and take a best guess at what that material is so they can then determine how to recycle it. That doesn't work, it's not economical, it doesn't scale, and 90% of the time they're guessing, so any recycling stream is actually damaged and not readily reused on the resale market. So basically what we've developed is a system for tagging whereby this tag actually correlates with a unique identity in the cloud that gives a recycler all the information correlated with this product. This tag is actually put on the product at time of production. And you could ask, okay, what manufacturer is going to put on this additional tag at time of production? Well, they're actually doing this already. Manufacturers, the H&Ms of the world, the Zaras of the world, for their entire supply chain, they're tagging their products. And they're using this kind of system in the supply chain already. But right now, they actually take off that tag at point of sale so that they can't leverage that information at end of life. So what we did was we designed a certain kind of tag, which is its RFID thread, that goes onto your garment, and it's used for the same supply chain purposes as the other tags that exist today, but it stays on the product, and it gives the recyclers the information that they need at end of life. So basically, this is your sweater. This is a thread on your sweater. This is a recycler. He doesn't look very much like a recycler, but he would scan your product and it would tell them, you know, this is 100% cotton, this is cashmere, this is that, right? Everything they need to recycle. So that system we're launching in April in Stockholm. Unfortunately, I can't tell you, but it will be very exciting for the fast fashion world because we're working with some bigger brands in that space. But this is what it will look like, and this is the kind of information that will enable seamless integration of textile recycling so that we can stop using new natural resources, stop polluting waters and streams and everything that we love, and start, you know, using the materials that are already available and accessible to us. So keep in touch. Good luck to you all. You're all at the best times of your life. I'm jealous. And thank you for having me.
Hi, I'm Ryan.
I'm Alex.
I'm Drew.
And we are current undergraduate students here at the University of Maryland and the co-founders of TurBinD. Currently, there's only two small-scale power options, solar and a grid tie. If you want to plug something in outside, you can either plug it in or you can slap a solar panel onto it. And a grid tie is the typical solution. It's the cheapest, it's the easiest. But with green construction at an all-time high, with a 9.5% growth rate compared to the 3.5% growth rate of regular construction, every organization wants to look green and sustainable. So they're stuck using these bulky, large solar panels that are typically out of view and don't even work on cloudy days. But there is a second option, wind. It's largely adopted on the large scale, but it has yet to be scaled down to a size where it could be used to power parking stations and charging stations and blue light emergency alert systems. Until now, I challenge you to rethink wind. I challenge you to think of how those large, faraway turbines could be shrunk to a scale where they could be put at a street corner and not danger everyone that walks past. We at TurBinD have thought a lot about this problem, and we've come up with a pretty clever solution. Our turbines can act as both a standalone solution and complement existing solar installations to increase uptime.
So what our solution is a small-scale vertical axis wind turbine that acts as a low-power off-grid utility. What we bring, like our benefits in terms of other companies, is we are affordable, reliable, and the installation is easy and almost seamless. Our turbines can be injection molded, bringing the cost down to around $200. And as college students, this might seem like a lot, but this is only about like 2 months worth of Starbucks coffees. In addition, you can ensure that our turbine will not break because there's only one moving part and our electronic system is a lot simpler than solar electronic systems. Finally, our turbine can be stuck in a hole in the ground and work independently, or can be attached and integrated with existing solar or other systems with only a few wires, making it a lot simpler to set up than a grid tie. So, how our turbine works might not be immediately apparent, but we use a vertical axis Gorlov-style wind turbine that uses airfoils to create pressure differences inside and outside the turbine, which creates forces that spin the turbine. This has added benefits as it is more efficient for its size, and it can take wind from any direction, unlike the large horizontal three-prop turbines. Finally, it is the top choice for architects when trying to add wind power to LEED certified buildings.
So we decided to use the traditional business market to launch our turbine because we saw a visible path to entry, a clear growth strategy, and an opportunity to work with other businesses to create environmental impact. So what is our path to entry? We are launching in the parking station market. So currently, lots of these parking stations are solar powered. And the issue is solar only keeps these systems running 99% of the time, which sounds great. But if you have a parking lot with 100 spaces and you're down for 1% of the time, that can lead to a loss of $6,000 a year in revenue, not to mention the frustration that this causes patrons trying to use your parking lot. So we want to make these systems more reliable by adding wind power to it. But it doesn't end there. With the growth, we're able to expand nationwide, piggybacking off of the increase in implementation of these solar systems. And looking past the parking lot, there are hundreds of different applications that we could go into that all involve low power utilities. So, So 54% of the population lives in urban areas. And by 2050, that's going to reach 66%. Now, that causes an issue where people are disconnected from their power. More people are living further away from where their power is produced. And now you might be wondering, what issue does this actually cause? Well, if you don't see your power, why would you care how it's made? And how are we supposed to inspire a future generation to think green and try to stop our use of fossil fuels if they're not seeing renewable energy on a daily basis? So we want to have people seeing energy wherever they are all the time so they can think green. And that's where we think businesses need to step in. It is more important now than ever before that businesses take the lead as being sustainable leaders and work towards a greener future. So with our turbines, since you'd see it on a daily basis, looking when you go and pay at a parking station, you're interacting with it daily. That's a reminder that we need to think about sustainable energy and what we can do to work towards a better future. So We are always hearing great ideas when we talk to people. And we would love if any of you guys have an idea for the future applications of TurBinD, please go to our website at turbine.com or find us on Facebook and let us know what your great idea is. Thank you.
You're going to do it. Thank you. I'm really bad with the slide. My name is Ariela Suster. I'm from El Salvador, and my company is called Sequence. We make handcrafted jewelry and accessories. So I'm here to talk to you about how I turned my personal mission into a sustainable business. I feel like when I grew up in El Salvador, during the Civil War, and my family experienced violence firsthand, and thankfully, I had the opportunity to study in the United States and leave El Salvador because it was too dangerous for me to live there. And I always knew that at one point I would go back to El Salvador and really make an impact and make a difference and address the issue of violence. But when I was in college, I had no clue how I was going to do it. I also majored in dance and psychology, so it wasn't really leading into a path of creating a sustainable business. But I knew I had that purpose and that mission inside. So many years after, I worked in the fashion industry, and I knew at one point it was a time where I had built a platform that I could launch a business using all the contacts and everything that I had worked in fashion. So I went back to El Salvador. And now in El Salvador, I think you saw the picture before that. The biggest issue in El Salvador now is gangs and gang-related violence. Young men are joining the gangs. El Salvador is the most dangerous country in the world with the most murders per capita. And so going back, I thought, you know, the issue is so big. How am I going to make a difference in a tiny way? I don't even have a business background. But, you know, I think I'll share with you some of the tools, and my email is at the end of the presentation if you have more questions. But one of the most valuable things that I had, I knew the why I was doing what I was doing. And I knew that the why was so strong that the how, I was going to figure it out along the way. So one of the biggest lessons that I learned when I launched my business was the importance of having that strong mission and knowing that mission and knowing that, you know, this is what I'm all about. I was all about disrupting the cycle of violence that limits at-risk youth. And how am I going to do that? What's my economic engine? So I had an amazing mentor who put me through this hedgehog. I don't know if you've read the book Good to Great, but it analyzes, like, what am I passionate about? And then what am I best at in the world? And then what's the economic engine? So for me, figuring that out way at the beginning was key. Because then I knew, okay, the economic engine, I could work through it. But if I have that strong mission, I could go out there and really convince people to buy my products. So one of the main focus was to employ young men who lived in at-risk communities that were surrounded by gang-related violence and teach them how to make the craft. So we taught them how to make jewelry, how to make bracelets and necklaces. I brought all the product back to New York. I launched the collection the way that I knew how to launch a fashion brand, except it was a big failure. It didn't work. I got into all the stores, and it was great. I got tons of press. I got tons of support, but my products weren't selling. And so I was just in shock. I'm like, what happened? You know, I have such a strong mission. The products are so cool, but why is this not working? And so, you know, going back and thinking, okay, the story at that point had gotten lost. Nobody really knew at the point of sale what these pieces meant, who had made them, or why. And so I was at the point where, okay, I created this business, yet there's no response. I have no economic engine behind it at this point. So also I went back to my mentor, who said, look, this failure is the biggest opportunity you'll ever have. Now you just need to think about what other people could be engaged or you could use as a platform to sell, not just sell your products, but also make a difference for their lives as well. And so not just think about your customers as people that you're selling to, but also how can you make a difference in their lives as well? And how can they feel engaged in the process? So we started with a lot of partnerships and collaborations. We focused a lot on corporate gifting and also creating products with different, like bigger companies, and raising awareness of our business model. So it was great for a lot of the brands to partner with us because they could engage in something that was creating social change. And at the same time, they had the budget to support that. So we developed different products that then we could use and turn into used company logos or do different. We developed a bracelet with Microsoft that had an NFC technology that when you tapped your phone, you could figure out a way to trace where that bracelet was made and who was making it and sort of see through a video of all the guys making the bracelets. That's the story, and the vision for the future is to continue to create more of these partnerships. And I've done a couple of talks at universities, and I've seen such the young students wanting to engage in things and make a difference, but not knowing how. So one of the ideas was to launch a college tour, which we're doing and starting in September, sharing more of the tools and going more in depth of how I created my business, and then having a platform as well for mentorship and to also engage with the students to be able to help create businesses that can create more social change. So that's my email and Instagram.